sad. You can just feel the sadness they have. And they're standing there, and all of a sudden there's two men with just clothes gleam like lightning. So you can imagine how fearful that had to be. And these two men stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee? The Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again." Then they remembered his words. Let's stand.
Yeah.
good that we have has come from you. And we're being your obedient children by giving back. I pray that you use this to further your kingdom. I pray you'll guide and direct the people that are making the choices about how this money is spent. I ask, as I always do, Father, that you'll bless this gift and the giver. And it's in Jesus' name. Amen. Now we've got two blessings coming. Sid's going to sing, and then my old friend John Swenson is going to bring us the message. So be blessed.
On a hill far away, back and have one of the wonderful meals that you guys prepare. ladies also. And just the warmth that I felt. For those of you who don't know me, I was pastor here from 2000 to 2002, basically, and preached a little bit before that because they needed a preacher. I'm more of a teacher, actually, than I don't yell a lot or anything, so. It's great to be back, and the warmth that I felt from the people that knew me then, so to speak, has been great. Good friends here, and warm wishes all around. My family, my wife's named Doe, and she's doing well. We just got back from Sanibel Island. We spent 3 months there, and she loves the sun. She loves the beach. She loves the ocean. She loves seashells and seagulls. And she's in withdrawal right now a little bit, but it's so beautiful around here. It's a great time to come back, right? For the Northern Hemisphere, at least, what a great season for the Lord to be risen from the dead. There's new life all around us, and you know, the seasons are kind of like a cycle of life. I think everybody has seen that analogy or heard that analogy before, and what a beautiful time to celebrate Jesus Christ risen from the dead. There's new life all around us. The fawns have been born, the baby goats have been born. Our granddaughter has been born March 27th. We have a grandson and a granddaughter now. And so my wife's been up in Williamsburg, Virginia, helping care for the baby and stuff. So there's new life all around. And what a great day to celebrate the risen Lord. So I'd like to pray. I always hope that God will do something with whatever it is that I have to say, so it helps if He's behind it, right? And so here we go. Father, will you please speak with us today? You rose in one respect to be seated at the right hand of the Father on that throne of grace so that we can come to ask for help in our time of need. So Lord, we need you today. I need you. Speak through me if anyone is to be changed in any way. So Holy Spirit, we invite your presence. Lord Jesus, we ask you to speak to us through your word. In Jesus' name, amen. So what I'm going to do is go cover the surrounding events leading up to the crucifixion. Judy mentioned some of them. And then just talk about the importance of crucifixion, and then really what our response should be. And I was given this verse. I think this came from the Lord, but it's really simple. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, or I liked another version better, declare with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Let me read again. If you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Very simple, right? It's a conditional promise, isn't it? If you do this, God will do that. And so that's what we're going to talk about. But let's first look at the Holy Week a little bit. I wrote down some things on what happened day by day. And it was quite a week for the disciples, really, if you think about it. So Jesus comes into the temple on Palm Sunday, which you celebrated here last week, I assume. And it's quite a party, right? Everybody's rejoicing, and the children are crying out and saying Hosanna. Which is a praise word, but it basically means save. They're treating Jesus, recognizing him as the Son of David, as the Messiah. And to the disciples, it's like, finally, he gets the credit he deserves, right? Glory to God that he's being recognized as what we know him to be, the Messiah, the Son of God. And so, great day. Next day, Jesus goes in, and clears the temple of the money changers. And he says, my house will be called a house of prayer. And I love that 40 hour prayer leading up into the Easter celebration, because his church should be a house of prayer. And here it is, this gentleman standing up and thanking you for the prayers that he felt them. That's a testimony to you being a house of prayer, which is just as the Lord would have. So, and it just, by the way, what you've done since I've been here, you know, with the building and just the growth of the church and the sweet spirit that's here, congratulations. This is a blessing from God, and you have been, I think, letting the Holy Spirit work through you to accomplish these things. So so Jesus is angry because they're taking the house of God and making it into a money-making operation instead of a house of praise, a house of prayer. And then Tuesday and Wednesday, it seems to say that he's in the courts daily, teaching just like he always did when he went to Jerusalem. He'd be in the temple courts teaching and healing people. And then comes the Passover. And so Jesus sent somebody for the colt. When the colt was there, Jesus said somebody, hey, you'll run into a man, and he'll have a room for you, you know, for us to prepare the Passover. So Jesus is doing these little miracles of foreknowledge, just leading up to it. And the disciples have been seeing this for 3 years, just who he was. But think about the Last Supper. You realize that Jesus washed Judas' feet. If you read the account, Judas leaves after. I just think that's amazing. Jesus washed Judas' feet. And then, of course, they have what we call the Lord's Supper. And this is my body given to you, broken for you, to forgive your sins. This is the new covenant in my blood that we celebrate today, to remember his death, to remember the great things that he has done. And then, of course, he's arrested. So now the disciples, Jesus has claimed he will never deny the Lord. Peter has claimed to have never denied the Lord, and yet he denies him 3 times. Everybody runs. Strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered. It was an Old Testament scripture, and Jesus is alone. And then, of course, they crucify him, and as Judy said, they lost the one they were depending on as the Savior of the world, as the Messiah, as the one they thought would be king, but they weren't listening when he said, I've got to go to Jerusalem, I've got to die, and I'm going to be raised from the dead. And they weren't listening when he said he was going to die, and they certainly weren't listening or understanding when he said he's going to be raised from the dead. And they asked themselves, and one of the scriptures said, they asked themselves what being raised from the dead would mean. I don't know if there are too many, you know, ways to take that, right? So you're either raised from the dead or not, I don't know, but they couldn't hear it yet. They couldn't hear it, and even when they were told on Easter morning by the ladies, so they had a Saturday where I'm sure they were grieving, wouldn't you think? And Peter, he went out and wept bitterly after he denied the Lord, and I bet the rest of them that ran away felt the same way. And Judas, of course, well, we know what he did. He took his own life because of his guilt and shame. So then they hear from the women that Jesus is alive. And some of them don't believe him. You know, even after all this, they still don't believe. And then finally, they all see Jesus. Now, from that point on, they are changed. And from that point on, they are witnesses to the resurrection. They wait for the power of the Holy Spirit, and when they come out And because Jesus had expounded to them the scriptures for that 40 days when he was with them, he told them all about all the Old Testament scriptures, about what was happening, where they were in history, and what was going to happen. And Peter just stood up right away. This is what Jesus promised. This is what the prophet Joel said. And there they were. And but a little bit before that, in Acts 1:22, they were looking for the 12, the one to replace Judas. And they were looking for somebody who would be a witness of the resurrection. It was that important to them. They wanted somebody who had seen Jesus. So my question here from the scripture I read is, so why is it so important that we believe that Jesus has been raised from the dead? What if we believe that he died for our sins? Isn't that enough? And as I said earlier this morning, what I came to the conclusion is those two go together. That if he said he was going to be raised from the dead and died for our sins and wasn't raised, then he really wouldn't, he couldn't have been God. He couldn't have been the Messiah. The test of a prophet is that what they say comes to pass, right? So, let's go through that scripture. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, that's the first part of it. If you say that seriously, it means Jesus is master and I'm not. Jesus' word is law and mine's not. God is smarter than me, believe it or not. Smarter than me too. At certain times in my life, I thought I was smarter than God. That gets you in a lot of trouble. A lot of trouble. And I did get myself into some trouble. But on a day-to-day basis, we often question God. I think it's okay to question God in prayer and say, why is this happening, Lord? I think that's good. David did it in the Psalms. I think we cry out to God, Lord, what's going on? How could how could this be right? I think that's all okay. But when you start thinking that you have an answer that's better than his, that's where you have a problem. And that's why we should rejoice in all circumstances, because God tailors the circumstances of our lives to bring us to the point when his will he will perform. And my experience of God's way of handling things is he uses techniques and situations in a way that I would never expect, and they turn out so much better than I would expect. He's smarter than we are. So when we say he's Lord, we're saying we are going to be there bowing down. And when we come to the throne of grace to ask for help, we're not telling him what to do. We're presenting our requests with thanksgiving and trusting them to him, knowing that he'll change something for the better. Not necessarily the way we want, but that he will hear our prayer. He will give us spiritual victory, even though in the natural it might not be what we want. But he's not after the flesh. He's not after certain circumstances turning out to be rosy on earth. He's after holiness, and he's after devoted followers, and he wants to meet with us in new ways and reveal our blind spots and change us into being more like his son. So when he answers a prayer, he has that as his first priority. Spiritual victory in Christ. And so that's what he does. He's Lord, we're not. And my testimony is that God revealed himself to me in 1974, but I still didn't believe the moral rules of the Bible. I'll just leave it at that. I won't get into graphic details. But I did not believe the moral rules of the Bible. I did not follow the moral rules of the Bible. And after I became a believer, I actually did worse things than before I became a believer, for which God, in his mercy, forgave me. But it was because I did not make him my Lord. I wanted him to be my Savior, but I did not. So the Old Testament says, and I love this now, that he gives us his commandments for our good. His rules are not designed to restrict our freedom and make us unhappy. Rather, for our good, so that we can have abundant lives, so that we can have joy in things that are important and good instead of temporary joy of drinking or drugs or whatever. And so, believe me, I tried all that, and I woke up with a hangover, like a major life hangover. Okay, so now, going on here in this passage, we have to believe in our heart God's raised him from the dead. So let's look at the purpose of his death and resurrection. So we know that the gospel is, it starts with the word repent, usually. Like Greek, that in Greek, that the technical meaning is rethink. Rethink your way of acting. Rethink your way of, rethink your mental processes. Start over. Think again. That's what it means. And in practical matter, it means rethink with a change. You know, rethink with willingness to change. And this is repent and confess your sins, and you will be forgiven because of what Jesus did on the cross. That's the gospel, right? And so the purpose of the cross, obviously, was that he bore all our punishment. And, you know, when you ask, were you there? I mean, sometimes there's a fairly modern hymn that talks about, I hear my mocking voice cry out among the scoffers. You know, in a way, we're partly responsible for the fact that Jesus had to die. And so we kind of identify, in some sense, with being there and saying, oh, he died for me. That pain was for my sake, not just mine, but for all of ours, but for mine too. And to really believe that, to believe that when I got saved, God knew my past sins, and he knew my present deception or whatever, and he knew every future sin. And with his mind, the worst things I've done were as present to him as the moment I did them. Think about that. You know, I wouldn't want them broadcast. With him, they're as present because of his mind. He remembers everything. It's hard to imagine. He remembers everything he's ever done throughout history. And he knows what we're going to do, but yet he chose me. And he chose you if you'll receive him. And it says, to those who receive him, he gives the power or the authority to become children of God. So that's why he died. Now, what about the resurrection? I think we have to believe that it's a historical fact. I think, you know, it's not a myth. The fact is, Jesus was died, was buried, and rose from the dead. Now, there's a lot of evidence of that that I'm not going to get into, but the thing that kind of made the most sense to me is, why would the disciples who saw Jesus and said they'd seen him risen from the dead lay down their lives in the task of proclaiming the gospel if they hadn't seen Jesus? And it says that he appeared to over 500 people. And when Peter got up on Pentecost, he said, we all have seen him risen. There were 120 that he was speaking for. They'd all seen the risen Lord. And many of them, all the 12, except for, I guess, John ended up dying in prison, but all of them gave their lives for the sake of the cause. Why would they do that if it wasn't true? So it's a historical fact. I think we also have to understand what the resurrection is for in our own lives. That when Christ died and rose again, it was so that we could rise again. Not just on the last day for eternity in heaven, but that we would also be able to crucify the flesh. We would also be able to die to the old self and live a new life in the power of the Holy Spirit. Jesus said, it's good for you that I go away, because I will send to you the comforter or the helper, the one who walks alongside you. The Spirit of truth, Jesus said, I'll send him. I will not leave I will come to you. So there's something about his resurrection and ascension that released the power of the Holy Spirit on the earth, as we saw at Pentecost. And now, what do we have? The opportunity to invite. When they say, have you asked Jesus into your heart? You have the opportunity to invite the Spirit of God into your heart by faith, so that you will be, we will be temples of the Holy Spirit. And the opportunity to continually be filled with the Holy Spirit. That's what it says in Ephesians. Be continually filled with the Holy Spirit. Problem is, we leak a little, right? So we need to be refilled with the Holy Spirit. So all of these blessings come through the resurrection. There's a power over sin that comes through the resurrection. Let me read Romans 6, 1 through 5. Again, it's just really... So one of the things that people accused Paul of was teaching everything was by grace, so you didn't have to worry about sin anymore, and you can just do whatever you want, and you would be saved. That error is still around. It's not true. And so here's what Paul says to that. What shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning that grace may increase? By no means. We are those who have died to sin. How can we live it any longer? Or don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of God the Father, we too may have a new life. Paul says the only thing that matters is a new creature. Jesus said you must be born again, or born from above. Those two words, that word can be used either way, again or from above. And both are true. We must have a rebirth in our spirit. We must have a resurrected spirit. And that's the power that Jesus released in the resurrection. Now, so if we confess with our mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in our heart God is raised from the dead, we will be saved. We can be saved from fear. We can be saved from the power of sin. We can be saved from obsessive worry. But this morning I want to talk about making him Lord of our lives in two very significant areas. And these are what we say in university, these are prerequisites to live the kind of life that God wants you to live. I think you can get by maybe and end up in heaven. But if you want to live the life of joy and peace here that God wants to live, there are two great commandments that we have to be careful of. Because since Christ has forgiven us of so much, we also ought to forgive one another. It says that over and over in the Bible. And we can't really have peace and joy with the weight of guilt we have if we won't pass that forgiveness on. And so the question is, have you forgiven everyone that's harmed you of everything? Now, one thing about forgiveness you have to remember is it doesn't mean you're justifying what they did if it was wrong. If it's wrong, it's wrong. If it's evil, it's evil. If it's disgustingly evil, it's disgustingly evil. And you don't look at it and say, well, it wasn't that bad. That's not forgiveness. That's glossing over evil. What forgiveness is looking at the depth of it and the effect it's had on you and the way that it's harmed your life and saying, Father, forgive them. They didn't know what they're doing. Just like Jesus said on the cross. Father, forgive them. They didn't know what they're doing. Because if they knew that you were an eternal soul saved by God and the one that Jesus died for, if they knew that you were sensitive to this or that this would have harmed you in that way or messed your life up in that way, if they really knew the Lord of hosts and the truth of the matter, they would have done it. If they really knew. So you say with Jesus, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. And that's the first step. Before you can say, I forgive, it's just good to say, okay, God, please don't hold this against them. You know, for that might be the place to have to start. And then to just release and say, and I forgive. I forgive them, Lord. And maybe I have to forgive them tomorrow and the next day and the next day until God gives me peace and it doesn't come back. But, you know, I remember a lady, she lost her husband right here at Fulton on Valdez going out of town. He was in a marathon. The guy was an Ironman. He was in a marathon, and I guess 500-mile bike race or something. He's riding up the hill there on F, way over on the shoulder, and somebody veers off, hits his car, and he died. And she came in my office when I was on staff at a church in Columbia, and she says, I have to forgive him every day, because every day I wake up and Mike is gone. But she did, and she's doing well. She's got peace and joy now, and God helped her. The second main commandment, so let's take a moment. You just express your willingness to God, Lord, I forgive, help me with my unforgiveness. Just for a moment, Lord, I forgive. Second thing that the scripture says is, do not judge, or you will be judged. There's a third one, confess your sins, and he's just and faithful to forgive us, give you, and cleanse of all righteousness. So don't forget to confess your sins. That helps you get a sense of forgiveness, and it's important for you to acknowledge them. But do not judge, or you will be judged. You cannot have peace and joy when you're looking down on other people. When you look at somebody and say, I never could have done that. I remember some things I said in high school that I never would do. I've never been an alcoholic like my father. A few years later, I was exactly like my father. I judged my dad. I judged my mom. I didn't, but the day that I stopped judging them and started forgiving them, I'd have to say it was the best day of my life. Because I didn't know the weight of guilt I was carrying around with all my judgment and with all my unforgiveness. And I didn't know the release I would have the day that I said, okay, Lord, I forgive them. And all of a sudden, I understood what peace with God was all about. I'd already been met by the Holy Spirit. I had some joy, but I didn't know there was this weight of guilt on me because I wasn't willing to do for others what Jesus had done for me. Do not judge. Forgive everyone of every sin all the time. Prerequisites for peace. Prerequisites for the kind of life God wants us to lead. I think that's what it means when you say Jesus is Lord, because he commanded us to love our enemies. He commanded us to forgive so that we'd be forgiven. He commanded us not to judge. He commanded us not to think of ourselves better than anyone else. In fact, he told us to honor others above ourselves. So let's stick with that. Let's do it the Jesus way. Let's be the most forgiving and gracious people on the face of the earth because Jesus has been forgiving and gracious to us. And that is what attracts people. It says, by this will all men know you are my disciples if you have love one for another. And it's the people we're closest to sometimes it's hardest to forgive. It's easiest to judge. And a lot of times that happens inside the church, doesn't it? Well, let's be different. Let's forgive. Let's put ourselves in the other person's place and ask God to help us instead of wanting to hurt them. So, that's really all I have to say. Can we pray together? Father, we ask you to fill us again with your Holy Spirit. We ask us again to fill us with your spirit of compassion and love. And be like you who forgave your enemies. In a very real sense, they knew they were nailing your hands. They knew they were crucifying you. They knew they were intentionally inflicting pain on you out of their bitterness or because it was their job as a soldier. soldier. But you said, Father, forgive them, they don't know what to do. Stephen, when he was dying, said, Father, do not hold this sin against them. Let us follow the path of Jesus and Stephen, Lord. Let's be a forgiving and gracious people. Let us be kind and patient and gentle. And Lord, we know we will fail. Help us when we're not. Help us when we're blind to our judgment or unforgiveness. Show us the truth. Let the light set us free. Let the truth set us free. Father, we just commit again to receive you as our Lord and Savior. Thank you that we have the privilege of being your children. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
This Lamb of God. church are Roland Bartley and Steve Arrowwood and John Smart. I know any of those would be more than happy to talk with you and pray with you, or any of us that go here. I just don't want you to leave here today with a need and desire in your heart that wasn't there. Our song that we're going to close with this morning is "Lord, I Lift Your Name on High," and I think we need to stand up to be high. Thank you.